How's about this for a dream? Had this dream last night, and in this dream I was like totally happy and feeling of friendship with everything and everyone. And no matter what I did, it didn't go away. I kept in the dream. I kept going places and doing this. And you know what? What is this? It won't go away. You know, how can I get it? I don't know if I was trying to get it to go away or not, but it just remained steady with me. It was just steady. I was like going steady with happiness. I don't know what to say. Anyway, I've never had a dream like that. It was quite extraordinary. All right, well, I've had a lot of extraordinary dreams, and they never seem to quite surface, you know, and surface consciousness seems to. Speaking of surface consciousness, this began the day by examining surface consciousness, and I came up with a lot of insight into it, and very, very helpful. And it gets back to the neither nor practice, being super important. Truth neither emerges nor does it not emerge. It neither emerges nor does it not emerge. Okay? It neither surfaces nor does it not surface. Truth neither surfaces nor does it not surface. So I'm finding more and more clarity about this neither nor practice and how profound it is and helpful it is. Because really what we are, it cannot be defined in any way. And yet we're so used to definition that to throw all definition away forever, it's too radical, too extreme for us. Speaking of extremism, our friend, neither a friend nor not a friend, the Pope, gave a speech in Congress today, a joint session of Congress, United States Congress. And then after the speech, he appeared on the balcony of the second, third floor, just like, it seemed just like at St. Peter's. I mean, I said, wait a minute, where are we, at St. Peter's? Are we at the rotunda of the congressional building? Well, he came out on this balcony of just like at St. Peter's when the Pope, you know, speaks to the, or like when the Pope gets elected, he comes out, or he was speaking to the crowds below. Same thing, he came out and the crowd went absolutely crazy. And I was like, I was watching a streaming of it, and I was just dumbfounded, you know, really. Wow. Quite extraordinary. Wow, what's going on? Is this suddenly, he showed his popularity and his power and all this, you know, to Congress. It's really quite extraordinary. I read a transcript of a speech too, read it through. And it's a very, very interesting humanistic document. And I read between the lines, and I understand what they're getting at here. It's the same old, folks. It's the continuity fear doing its little dance. Okay, doing its little dance. Trying to squeeze truth out. Trying to squeeze truth out. Or as some people say, edging God out. The ego edges God out. Continuity fear edges God out. The ego edging God out. And it's if you really understand what the continuity fear is about, the ego, you can see, you know, whoever the papal speechwriter is very clever and very smooth, but it cannot fool those who have the Holy Spirit clarity within them. And you can understand what they're getting at, but it's very a lot of Jesuitry, you might say. That's a word, I think. Casuistry and Jesuitry, sort of a way of, like, for instance, the Pope responded to someone saying that, hey, he said, a lot of, on plane coming over the United States, he said, a lot of people are saying that I'm the Antichrist. He says, you know, there's some lady who said that I didn't wear the red shoes when I was elected Pope, and she said, that means I'm the Antichrist, you know. And she says, well, you know, I said, lady, you know, it's you're entitled to your opinion, but, and so, you know, he likes to address this issue and try to poo-poo it by someone silly thought I should wear. But if you look at this document, you know, it's very humanistic. Now, humanism is the Antichrist. It's that which is against Christ. It's that which is against us realizing what we really are, which is spirit, which is what Christ stands for, means spirit. divine spirit created by God. That's what we are. So humanism tries to, under the guidance of continuity fear, to edge God out, edge truth out. And they talk about extremism. We must combat extremism in religion. It's so important. We cannot have polarization. Everyone has to be all-inclusive. You know, in other words, what he's saying is everyone must agree with humanism. And anyone who doesn't is an extremist. This is where they're going. There's no question about it. This is the march. They're on the march so that they can label those who speak truth in the world as extremists. You know, this is what they hope to do. This is what the continuity fear always hopes to do. So when you know what the continuity fear's agenda is, then you listen to people in the world, and you can hear, oh, they're just reflecting. You know, got a mirror up and reflecting the continuity fear. See a Pope with a mirror and he's just reflecting the continuity fear. Now, I'm not out to get anybody or be angry with anybody, go out of my way. No, that's fine. I mean, the Pope's doing his best to be a nice person and trying to be helpful and saying a lot of things that sound really good and everything, so that's great. But he's not the good shepherd. He's not shepherding anybody to salvation at all. You know, he's a secular humanist, plain and simple, in the garb of religion. Let's say it again. He is a secular humanist in the garb of a religious person. That's not surprising. I mean, a lot of religions have situations, similar situations too. Very few are actually shepherding anyone to salvation. India system tries to stay away from that by having the gurus, various situations where they don't have just like a hierarchical structure that ends up with the Pope, you know, setting policy, and it goes down to everybody, because that, you know, then it's easy to have secular humanism just dominate. Whereas each guru has their own lineage, they don't have to agree with one another, and so it's very difficult to get some sort of, you know, secular humanistic dominance over that sort of situation. And I you know, there's a lot to be said for that, actually. You know, when the gurus are not expected to agree with one another necessarily, and they get together every 4 years or so, Kumbh Mela, and they talk, and some of them get together and dialogue, etc. But they say, okay, we agree to disagree on this, and we agree on this. It doesn't matter, you know. We keep, you know, we understand that there's a lot of different ways to practice and to go towards finding, you know, dropping your pretense. But these big religions, these mega religions that are got this pyramid, you know, with the policy from the Pope, policy goes down through the pyramid to everybody. You know, well, this is very worrisome, because you know, who can say no to it within that religion? Really, it's very tough. And so, I mean, Catholicism is says a lot of nice stuff. Nobody's disagreeing with that, and a lot, you know, well, not many. I mean, you know, they look at their agenda they lay out, and okay, fine. Some Protestantism also can be, you know, charities, a lot of stuff that's helpful. And then some Protestants go a little too far, and they say, well, Jesus is coming back, and if you've repented and been saved, and you know, you've done the necessary blah blah blah, you're going to heaven. Everybody else is going to be like completely devastatingly scorched by fire and fried and barbecued into some eternal torment and to complete destruction. You know, this is what they say. I mean, this is you couldn't get farther away from God by believing in such nonsense. And this just causes people to be terrified of Jesus. You know, they're really trying to scare people away from Jesus is what they're doing. I mean, Jesus is just like, wow, come on. Now, the people who are trying to follow the continuity fear may bring physical destruction upon themselves. That's happened, you know, may happen. I mean, this isn't God calling, Jesus judging anyone. And Jesus doesn't judge anyone, actually. Neither does God, because Jesus knows that all of us are perfect, flawless spirit, can never lose our standing in with God, with reality. So there's absolutely nothing to judge. There's nothing to judge. Jesus isn't hanging around poring over some spiritual accounting books and saying, okay, you know, who's been naughty and who's been nice? I got to judge. He's not doing any judging at all. Maybe that's why he's so happy. Maybe this is the friendliness that's going to come upon me or something. It's just I'm out of the judgment business completely. Everybody in this world is so strong in many ways, judging this way, judging that way. It's easy just to say one final judgment for all, which is there is no judgment. We're all perfect spirit, spiritually perfect, pretending not to be. So the Pope is going to speak to the United Nations tomorrow, and we get the drift of what the Pope says. I mean, basically, he's giving a pat on the back to Catholicism with one hand. On the other hand, he's giving a pat on the back to humanism, secular humanism. This is what he does. This is what this Pope does. And then out of the other side of his mouth, he says he abhors polarization. Let's not have any extremism anywhere. You know, let's everybody work together. Let's all be one and work together. On what? I mean, Jesus' whole thing is that there is no compromise in between truth and lies. You can't have it both ways. You can't serve two masters. Here's the Pope patting religion on the back with one hand and secular humanism on the back with the other. This is what he does. And, of course, that's called a populist, a demagogue populist, which is what he is. Again, there's no hatred or anger towards it. I'm just, in a friendly way, just pointing out so we're clear about it. This is what he is. He's not preaching the gospel. He's not preaching the gospel at all. There's no gospel in what he says. Which means the good news. Jesus brought the good news. And the good news is that all of this is just pretense. And we haven't changed what we are in the slightest bit. Not in the tiniest bit, not one iota have we changed ourselves or diminished our standing with everyone, with all, with God, within the one family of spirit. Within the one family of spirit, nobody's been diminished whatsoever. Nobody's been diminished whatsoever. Their standing remains flawlessly perfect. This is what Jesus knows. This is the good news. We don't have to earn it. There's nothing to earn. The more we try to earn, the more we end up in an urn, actually. So Jesus knows the good news. The Pope is not speaking the good news at all. He's not preaching the gospel at all. Not even remotely. He's preaching continuity fear. You know, we're all part of one human family. We're all human beings. We're all people. You know, we're born free as people. People. We're not people. We're not human beings. We're spirit. What kind of gospel is it to say that we're human beings? This is absolutely astonishing that anyone would think there's any gospel to what he's saying. Again, maybe nice man, caring man, humanitarian. Sounds like a humanitarian, which is fine, okay? That's what he is, okay? He's a humanitarian. He's not a good shepherd. He's not a pope. He's not preaching any gospel at all. He's not preaching any good news whatsoever. So the problem is, I mean, he needs to resign. That's why I excommunicated him already. I resigned him. I retired him already. Yeah, he doesn't realize it, but he's already been retired. With apostolic authority, I excommunicated the Pope because he should retire. I mean, he needs to step down. He's not preaching the gospel at all. He thinks he is by being humanitarian, but that is not true. Jesus was not a humanitarian, actually. Jesus preached the truth, and we've tried to twist it. And the continuity fear has tried to distort it. Of course, what else does this have to do? Yeah, this is the continuity fear. Our continuity fear distorts you know, everything, and twists everything into, you know, secular humanism as much as possible, and it's all those defense systems. It has many, 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 many defenses. So, but again, we've made friends with the continuity fear here. So I'm not condemning the continuity fear at all. I've made friends with it. Actually, it is us. It is our own fear. It's not some other fear. It's our own fear about we're afraid to stop pretending. It's that simple. We're afraid to stop pretending. And it's a very severe fear. We underestimate it. And it's such a severe fear, we try to avoid even thinking about it or looking at it. We say, oh, I don't want to look there. It's too scary. And it does seem scary when you start looking at it. It's very severe. But we've looked at it here and looked at it and looked at it and looked at it. Now it's not so scary. In fact, it's now our friend. And this morning I was rallying the continuity fear and saying, okay, continuity fear, it's time for you to be just totally elated. Get in a circle, you know, circle around this isness. I'm just going to sit there quietly, calmly, passively, but with this inner elation, like, wow. I'm being blessed by this. I can do this. I can do this. This is what really all our expressions that we've been imagining due to this continuity fear, they all want to be blessed by reality, by the truth, by us, by our truth, the truth of what we are. Absolutely, they do. So I have a very, very good relationship, great relationship with the continuity fear and all expressions of it, because we reached a deal. I neither accept them nor reject them. And so they trust me. They trust me, and I'm saying, okay, it's time for all these expressions of suffering, okay, in myriads of different ways. You know, get in this huge circle, like clouds, like a ring of clouds, but in the center it's completely clear. And let reality be revealed. Just allow it to be revealed by, you know, all the clouds just get consolidate into this ring of clouds, but it's all completely clear in the middle. And just sit there. You just sit there and enjoy it. Be elated for it. And I said, hurry up, you know. Do it fast. Got to get this done. And no conflict within me. I felt like, yeah, this is going to happen. They're all doing this. So, you know, made peace within. By being reasonable, truly reasonable, honoring our creativity in its engagement with all these expressions of suffering and misery and unhappiness, destitution and hopelessness and all that. This is a display, an amazing creative display on our part. So we're not going to just throw all those away. We're going to have this great honor, celebration and honoring, and allow them to realize, hey, you know, this has always been a play of our creativity, and now we're being blessed by our creativity. Our creativity is being blessed. So all these expressions are very, very eager, you know, to get this blessing. And the blessing is simply to see, to be aware, to feel, to experience the presence of reality, the presence of it, which, by the way, has no surface. And this gets back to surface. You know, surface consciousness, we don't have something emerge. Okay, truth does not emerge. It already just is. It doesn't go anywhere. What we do is the clouds part, and then we become, and all the action of the clouds that we're trying to follow, you know, that all parts and it's just quiet now, and so the mind becomes quiet, peaceful. It's not trying to judge any action of the clouds. And then it's able to experience the presence of peace, the isness of reality, okay? So it's not an emergence. It's not an overcoming. It's not a displacement. It's not, you know, any of those at all. Reality doesn't do anything. It doesn't move. So all the movement is in these clouds of belief and judgment. And continuity fear and defensiveness, these are all the clouds moving. But the clouds will now coalesce into this just this circle of condensed clouds around, and like a circle, and in the middle, totally clear, no clouds whatsoever. And then we're simply, this reveals what is. What is revealed in this way. It doesn't reveal itself. It doesn't emerge like like a submarine surfacing. It doesn't surface. It doesn't surface. So there is no surfacing that takes place. Rather, the clouds part to reveal what is there. So this is something I saw very clearly today. It's something I had a problem that was hindering me, is mistaken the thinking, I'm waiting for the truth to emerge. Come on, it's not emerged. It never emerges like that. It's not something that breaks into our consciousness. This is a problem that we've had because the way that it's been presented spiritually for quite some time by many is this idea of, you know, breakthrough in consciousness, a quantum leap, a shattering of, a killing of the ego, a shattering of this, of the delusion, and all that. No. That's not the way at all. That is not the way at all. That does not result in abidance at all. And so I was explaining this to all the continuity fear within, saying, okay, I'm on your side. I understand this is all wrong. You don't have to do anything. Just go off the periphery, like clouds on the periphery, and just sit there quietly. That's all you have to do. Don't have to do anything more. We're not trying to defeat you, triumph over you, have something suddenly emerge, surface, destroy, obliterate, shatter, none of that stuff. So the approach has been by many very, very much mistaken. We're after abidance here. We're not after some sort of glimpse, some sort of surfacing only to go back under the surface. We're after abidance. We're after 100% after abidance. That's all we're after. And when this is your goal, you begin to see it differently. You see, this is the goal. The whole structure of expectation changes when abidance truly is your goal. And not just some glimpse. You think like, oh, I'm some wretched beggar. Somebody's finally going to give me a gold coin someday. Someone's going to finally give me, and your whole purpose in life is just once. I just want a gold coin from somebody to be recognized as at least I have some value. I can get a gold coin. We're not after that. We're not beggars here. We're after absolute abidance. First abidance with honoring our creativity, but abidance. It stays. It's stable. We're after stable abidance. Nothing else. We're not after anything else. So this is why this approach just seems different. The other approach is the lesser approach. This is not. We don't have any interest in that actually. It seems to confound some, thinking they must think I have some interest in it. No interest in that. We're 100% focused on abidance here. Stability. So there isn't anything to surface. There's nothing that will surface. There's no surface play at all. So really, once the clouds part, we see the reality. We realize the reality doesn't have any surface. There's no surface at all, actually. But, and this is important, we have this pragmatic issue of expression in this world. Words, concepts, sentences, expressions. So we understand that and we deal with that in a certain way, the neither nor way. Well, I'm neither abiding in peace nor am I not abiding in peace. This is an expression, communication. It's because we're not, as soon as we form a concept of what we're doing, we're not stable anymore. So we have to practice stability. So there's a whole way of using language that supports abidance. And this is what people do not understand in this world. And I say people just for the sake of speaking. But of course, I don't really mean people. But as a common convention, we refer to one another as people. But we're spirit, pretending to be people. So I could say, so spirit pretending to be people in a pretend world, the convention, is how to, I think I just put it the right way previously. They're unaware of this language of a way to support abidance. They're unaware. The world is unaware of abidance as a goal. Really, I don't know if I've ever met anyone who really has abidance as their goal, or even heard of such a thing necessarily. I think we all believe that that's too, you know, it's way beyond our capacity or whatever. We don't even know, most don't even know such a possibility exists. We keep thinking that we want to find some sort of peak moment. At a peak moment. I glimpsed a peak in the far and distant clouds. Suddenly, the clouds parted way in the distance. I saw this mighty peak. Oh my gosh! You know, it was an amazing. And then that's our life. You know, we never even consider. Wait a minute. You know, what about everyone? You know, why not abidance? What's the goal really? So there isn't any language. There's no familiarity with the language that is used to support abidance, but there is a whole way of using language to support abidance, which is what we've been introducing here. Neither nor, both and, you know, both. It both is and it isn't. I'm both abiding and not abiding. I'm neither abiding nor am I not abiding. I'm both abiding and not abiding. This is the way of using language to support abidance. And the problem is that people think you're crazy if you talk this way, because they don't understand what the goal is, what the purpose is. So, it's a very troubled world here. It's actually not even a world. We've never been in a world. I mean, you know, I said to myself this morning, I said, you know what, I'm a world beater, actually. I'm truly a world beater. I beat the world. I'm a world beater. I don't beat the world, but I beat it. Meaning, but what is a world beater? A world beater realizes that there isn't any world. So I beat the concept. I've overcome the concept, the idea that there's a world. This is how I look at it. You know, you have to talk this way. There's never been any world. So, if, you know, we must overcome the notion that there's some world to overcome. We don't overcome the world, really. We overcome the notion that there is a world. So we're not technically world beaters. We've overcome the silly notion that there's some world to overcome. There isn't any world. So these are ways that those who are aiming at abidance, this is how they view it. They have a different way of conceptualizing, different way of expressing, different way, because they're supporting, honoring our creativity as expressed through the continuity fear. They're supporting that. In order to abide, you have to have the agreement of all these forms of expression of misery that we've imagined. You have to have their agreement, otherwise they will interfere with it. So you have to reassure them that they're not being neglected. So I'm both abiding and not abiding. I'm neither abiding nor am I not abiding. And this they take as acknowledgement. Acknowledgement. They're being acknowledged. They understand. They understand it. They get it. They're not stupid, because it's our own imagination and we're not stupid. So this is a way that we speak to ourselves now. This is the way how we express ourselves. And there's very little familiarity with this or precedent here, certainly in the West. I mean, I don't know what precedent we have about anything here, actually. The final word of the Pope's speech to Congress was dream, of course. You know. And he emphasized that, you know, we must keep dreaming. We must keep dreaming. We can, you know, don't stop dreaming. Of course, that's what the continuity fear wants, right? Don't stop dreaming. Holy cow, don't stop pretending. You know, you don't want to do that. That's crazy. Now, I'm trying to be more active and trying to, you know, prevent myself from just, you know, slipping too far down into just lethargy, etc. So I forced myself to go out again, try to play golf. I say try because that's pretty much that's what I was doing. I was trying. It was pretty rough. So, but it was okay because the Holy Spirit had a different purpose for it. You see, this is how the Holy Spirit, the brilliance, genius of the Holy Spirit is. It knows that, you know, looking ahead, it sees the whole picture and says, well, these are the things you need to get strong on, and the other stuff is not really important. You already can do that. So it interferes somehow, like your the stuff that you already know how to do, the Holy Spirit says, okay, you know you can do that. Why don't you work on something else that's difficult for you? And so it kind of messes up what you're good at. It says, won't let you really do it. I said, last time I was really good at this, and now it's like I don't even know how. Well, I understood the Holy Spirit saying, no, if you just do what you do are good, you'll keep doing it, and you won't practice the other stuff. You won't practice the other stuff, which is true, because we wanted to have some sort of feedback of success. So I couldn't do anything right there. I said, what's going on here? This is very odd. But I focused on some other stuff, which is being pressured by people on the course. And I succumbed to the pressure pretty badly because I have a very unorthodox, I was working on being very unorthodox with some pressure on me. And it didn't really, the results didn't matter. Just to stick with being unorthodox was what was important. And I even left golf balls on the golf course. I didn't even care. Yes, I'm not going to even bother with that. Oh, the ball goes in the sand trip. I don't care. I'll just go up in the putting green and just putt. I didn't even go get the ball. I just left them there. On one hole, I hit like two bad drives. One out of bounds right, one out of bounds left. I said, that's crazy. What's happening here? So I actually circled back to that hole. And there were some people who were on the previous hole. And I had to get out of their way quickly. So I just hit a tee shot and boom. I hit one, a good one there. And I said, Okay, I know I can do it here. And then I just left the hole. I just left the ball there. I just left the hole. I just took off. Went back to where I was before, and I just skipped the hole. Yeah, I just, you know, just doing stuff like that. Because the Holy Spirit's saying, you know, and also taking like three wedges with me every time I go up towards the green. Take three wedges, depending, you know, because you need a variety to choose from when you're trying to chip and pitch and all this stuff, depending on the slope of the ball and the rough and a lot of factors, the run out, everything. And so I started just taking, you know, three wedges in a putter with me every single time, which is very unorthodox. But you see, some people do that. Few people do that. The smart ones do, actually. But most people don't. They think, well, I'm so talented, I only need one club. Well, not really. You know, if you bring a variety, you actually can have more success. So, doing that and the unorthodox stance. So I was practicing being unorthodox and being pressured to play fast, and which is disastrous results. But which helps streamline your thought process and say, I really have to be more, you know, decisive and know exactly what I'm doing. So, you know, playing-wise, it was a disaster, total disaster. I didn't even bother keeping any score because it was such a disaster. But in the big picture, I gained some very, very, very important skills. And the spiritual path is like that. Don't worry about evaluating yourself, you know, as you go along too much. Just keep playing, keep practicing, keep with it, and notice, it'll come to your attention, hey, maybe if I do this, this will be helpful. Maybe you'll seem to struggle a bit or something. Well, you say, oh, it's okay. I think there must be some other thing, something of some other importance here. Oh, the other thing I do, which is nobody, I've never seen anybody do this. I'm not afraid to be, you know, very unorthodox. I play with two drivers. I've never seen anybody with two different drivers in the bag. Although, I don't know if Phil Mickelson might have done that once. He's very unorthodox, too. I'm not sure, but I have two drivers in the bag. One when I want the ball to fade right, one when I want it to draw left. Okay. And so I was struggling, trying to get those going, and was making bad decisions, like which one do I hit here, and you know, and so it was a struggle, but I kept at it. I kept at it. So I'm refining the situation here, but being awkward in the process. And it's the same thing on the spiritual path. We refine, we refine, we refine, and we do. We take risks. We're unorthodox, and we do that. We struggle a little bit. We struggle a little bit, you see? That's what happens. But we're not afraid to do that. We're not afraid to be unorthodox. And I feel I'm going to get it worked out one way or the other. And having two drivers is actually a very, very good idea. It really is. Because it actually is quite difficult to use one driver to change your stance, to change your approach, to do this and try to work the ball different ways. You end up really floundering that way. Only the really, really, really talented players can do that. The pros, really. But others, you know, they should stick with just one swing. But when they do that, you know, then they're not able to really play a golf course, which is can really test you in a lot of different ways. And sometimes you really want to make sure you don't go left. So you have to hit it right. But oftentimes when you do that, you hit it too far right. And it messes you up, and you see people just get messed up on a golf course. They all do. They get messed up. Same with the spiritual path. They have a tendency to get messed up. You know, so it's interesting using two drivers on the golf course, and also using this neither nor or both practice, both is and isn't. I'm both on the path and not on the path. I'm both succeeding and not succeeding, or I'm neither succeeding nor am I not succeeding. This sounds very unorthodox to people. They say, oh, you can't say that. It's unorthodox. You know, nobody does that. And but sure, actually, it's like the most important insight of all. It actually ends up with an inner accord. So if you get used to this, the more you get used to it, even though it may seem unorthodox, your game will go to a higher level. There's no question about it. And so even though I struggled, I came home and worked on it some more, and I figured out something, just a little key to hitting the different drivers, and I realized there's you need to take a slightly different approach with each one, and just learn that approach with each one, and I'm sure that this, well, I'm not never predicting golf. Don't predict, so I'm not sure about it. I'm both sure and not sure. Both sure and not sure that it's going to work. I'm both sure it's going to work and not sure it's going to work. I'm neither saying it'll work, nor am I saying it won't work. Do it like that. I'm neither saying it'll work, nor am I saying it won't work. It's both going to work and not work. Like that, and then your continuity fear relaxes with this. You relax, something relaxes within you. The pressure seems to be off. There's something that really loves this within you, really loves it, loves to hear this, and thanks you for it, says thank you so much. And I feel I'm going to be thanked, but the continuity fear is going to thank me for one, recognizing it, okay, being willing, very unorthodox. I don't know anyone else that's talking about the continuity fear except Jesus, and of course, a miracle is brought to my attention. So I thank Jesus for that, but, you know, it's very unorthodox to say this. So thank me for, you know, thank me for, wow, thank you for recognizing the continuity fear, and thank you for not attacking it, but just gently evaporating it. You know, working with it, acknowledging it, and evaporating it. And thank you for then acknowledging that you're going to honor the creativity, and we're not going to try and get rid of any of these expressions. You know, the expressions will go quiet and peaceful, and they'll actually all be elated to realize that they're part of this great honoring. All the sickness, all the depression, this being honored now. For the role it played in our creative, our dance of creativity, you see. And so the depression, that expression is now just going to be quiet, and there's no juice to it at all, but it's going to be elated. There's going to be, oh my, this is just wonderful, thank you so much. So all these aspects of our misery, of our pretense, are now going to thank me and the Holy Spirit and God, you know. But you might say, it might play out as thanking me for recognizing them and treating them fairly and treating them reasonably and justly, you know, not trying to project and disassociate and all that kind of stuff, but saying, no, you know, you did a great job defending me from fear. You know, all this misery was because the continuity fear was so severe. He said, no, I don't want to stop pretending, you know, distract me, you know. So these defenses did exactly what I asked them to do. And so why should they be, you know, excoriated for that? Rejected, vilified, attacked, defeated. Why? This is the wrong path entirely. The idea of triumphing over anything is the wrong way. No, say, bless them. I want to bless all of you. Sit in a circle. Let's all be blessed together. You deserve perfect blessing, actually. So they may have a big thank you for me, you know. And I'll let them thank me. Why not? Of course. And I do feel this inner accord within me. That something really great is happening by being willing to be so unorthodox. This is such an unorthodox approach. It's like bringing two drivers in your bag, but why not? I don't even need a 3-wood. I can't reach a par 5s and 2 anyway, so what do I need a 3-wood for? It's useless. That's the first thing you throw out of your bag. So I threw that out and... And I said, I had room for 2 drivers. You had to hit drivers on 14 holes, most likely. So that's important. Whereas a 3-wood, you're going to hit it, you know, maybe on 4 holes if you try to reach the par 5s and 2. But it's a very hard club to hit and get you in all sorts of trouble. So what's the point? You know, I've never had much success with a 3-wood. It can really cause a lot of problems for you. So just I leave it out. Leave it out. What's unorthodox about that? I hope I have the right number of clubs in the bag. I think so. 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Wedge, okay, and then 50-degree, 56 sand wedge, and 58 in the putter. There you go, 14 clubs. Yeah, I'm legit. So you could have 2 drivers. So, you know, in the approaching, being a very unorthodox approach is quite difficult in this world because you feel all alone. And nobody really supports you. They say, I want to play it safe here. Let me just stay with orthodoxy. But how much success is orthodoxy having in this world? Really, you look at it. I see hardly any success, actually. Usually the ones successful are some sort of unorthodox approach that, you know, and people say, wow, it worked. I mean, how did that work? Why did that work? You know, so maybe yes, there'll be some, you know, elation, you know, just some appreciation somehow will take place. But it doesn't seem unorthodox to me. It just seems very, very reasonable. Very reasonable. So we do the full stop on the wow. This is also unorthodox. The whole approach seems to be unorthodox, meaning it's not relying on orthodoxy. Yes, I'm not following along some orthodox path. Saying, well, this is what's been the path that's been tread before, so we must go this way, must go that way. I never was that way, and this is why the spiritual orthodoxy of the world, orthodox, they don't have never anything to do with me. They'd say, well, you're not following what we're saying, what the path that we're on, so, you know, I had to walk it alone. But I believe that reason is showing me every step is saying this is what reason is showing. This is what how to go about it. Again, what are we after? Abidance. We're not looking to get to heaven after we die. We're looking for abidance right here, right now. I'm not concerned about getting to heaven after I die at all. I don't even think about it. I want peace of mind right now, right here, right now. Abidance and peace of mind right here, right now. There's no other goal. Don't have any other goal. If I happen to find myself in the afterlife, same goal. I want to have peace of mind right here, right now. Abidance in it. Right here, right now, right here, right now. Now, I realize today that I've been working my whole life to break bad habits and get used to good ones. Get used to good habits. Huge effort, monumental effort. Break bad habits, start good habits, and keep them going. And in the past, there have been a lot of bad habits that the past was engaged in, okay? So I've tried to break all those bad habits of this world, of the past, and start some really great habits. Well, now here I am now realizing, hey, wait a minute. I'm looking at the future, and I'm saying, whoa, there's a whole new set of bad habits coming into this world that we're expected to follow. I said, wait a minute, I spent my whole life trying to get rid of bad habits, and now I've gotten rid of those bad habits, and now I'm expected to pick up a whole new crop of different bad habits in the future here. I said, I'm just spinning my wheels, I'm not getting anywhere. I'm not going to spend another lifetime trying to get rid of more bad habits, so I don't want to pick up those bad habits, the new bad habits at all. And I realized that the young people who come in this world, this is very important to accept that reincarnation is truly a fact. It's really just pretense. I mean, you don't stop pretending until you stop pretending. Now, this is something that Yogi Berra may have said, and let us mention the passing of Yogi Berra, number 8 for the New York Yankees, truly an American icon. Who has all these sayings, it ain't over till it's over. You know, if you see a fork in the road, take it. Hey, it's deja vu all over again. You know, so he has all these great sayings that have entered the language. I don't know anyone else who's had so many sayings enter the language. It's just extraordinary. He was an extraordinary man from St. Louis, Missouri. Small man, 5'7", has more World Series, 10 World Series as a player, and 4 more as a coach or manager. So 14 in all. And 3 MVP awards, and he passed away at the age of 90. Just a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful man. Everybody met him, just loved him. So what an extraordinary, kind, unpretentious person. You know, just so we lost a huge American icon yesterday, Yogi Berra. So, you know, maybe Yogi was a good name for him. Maybe he was a non-dual, you know, non-dual in some way. That's why he said the things that he said, you know. Nobody goes to that restaurant anymore. It's too crowded. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. So, I don't know, I lost the train of thought, but it's okay because we're talking about... Anyway, I said whatever I said. That's good enough. I can come up with some yogiism. the real name was Lawrence, I think, Lawrence, and somebody thought he looked like an Indian yogi if with his posture he had, so they started calling him Yogi. And he helped out. He helped the world out because he sort of brought a smile to our faces by the way he talked and stuff. And we started, hey, that sounds kind of non-dual, doesn't it? You know, do we always have to have things make linear sense to us, you know? That's beautiful. It's deja vu all over again. That's wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful way of using words is deja vu all over again. Beautiful. So thank you, Yogi. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You actually were a spiritual inspiration to this country and to the world. A lot of people, you know, wear these sayings. And very unorthodox, you know. He's very unorthodox in that way. But he wore it. He wore it beautifully. He wore it. People accepted it. And so we're using this both and neither, both and neither, both and neither. Bad habits is where we're getting at. Bad habits. Okay, this is important. Bad habits. Now, reincarnation. There you go, reincarnation. We keep pretending until we stop pretending. That's a yogiism. We keep pretending until we stop pretending. Pretending isn't over until it's over. So if we keep pretending that we're not what we are, we're going to find ourselves believing that we're in time, space, process, and form, that they're real, and they're not. People continue to do this. It doesn't stop just because we earn some brownie points somehow. I was a nice, charitable person. Okay, great. But as long as we keep pretending we're not what we are, we will keep pretending that we're not what we are. There's no magic involved in it at all. There's no magic whatsoever involved. So we carry habits of identifying with time, space, process, form, and all these various habits we carry, defense systems. This pretense, we carry it with us. It doesn't matter if the body dies. This is all mental. This whole pretending is mental. It's spiritual. So we just will end up identifying with another birth is what will happen. This is what we call reincarnation. But we carry all the habits that we have, mental habits, with us. When we identify with another body, the body's just neutral. The body isn't causing the habits. It's the mental habits that we have of pretense, spiritual pretense, that will just continue on with those habits, animating the body, having the body do stuff. The body's just neutral. It's like a rag doll. So you have all these people come into a world right now who have these habits that they've carried from other lifetimes, not necessarily on this planet, actually. There's many dwelling places in the universe and many ways to identify with time, space, process, and form, which is just an illusion. But so they bring their habits when they identify with the body here on this planet. They bring those habits with them. And so I'm finding the habits of young people to be extraordinary bad habits. They have a whole constellation of very bad habits. I don't want to have anything to do with those habits. I'm not going to gain those bad habits so that I have to work to get rid of them again. I already worked so hard to get rid of a whole constellation of bad habits. I don't need another constellation of bad habits. So I don't want the future here. I'm not interested. This is not for me. These bad habits are not for me at all. And the United Nations Sustainable Development Agenda is full of those bad habits. Full of them. And the Pope's speech is full of those bad habits. And what he says is full of them. The president's speech, the way his agenda is full of those bad habits. I don't want anything to do. I've already worked so hard to get rid of all bad habits that of the past that we've been engaged with. You know, I don't want a whole new crop of bad habits. No way. No way. No way. So what I say is we must go to the key bad habit from which all bad habits spring is what? Pretending we're not what we really are. This is the fundamental key bad habit from which all other bad habits spring from. All other bad habits spring from this one bad habit. So I say, wait a minute. My choice is either get these bad habits, the future is pressing upon us and demanding, in order to function, we'll have to have these bad habits. Or undo this one, break this one bad habit, this one key bad habit, the mother of all bad habits. From all offspring come from this one bad habit, is pretending to be something other than what we are. To break that bad habit. Once that bad habit is broken, no more identification, no more incarnation, no more returning, no return ticket to identifying with time, space, process, and form. You're free. You're free, free of that. We want to be free of this. So I'm saying, well, what are my options? Well, I can, you know, I mean, it's either pick up all these other bad habits that then will cause me a nightmare of trying to break them. It just goes on endlessly because new crops of bad habits keep coming on endlessly. This is the world. Or I can break the one key bad habit of pretense. So it's a no-brainer. Of course I'm going to go. Of course, breaking that one key habit is the right choice. It's the right option without any question. The other one is just, you know, notoriously terrible option. It shouldn't even be talked about as an option, and yet it is. If we don't break the one key bad habit of spiritual pretense, then we will continue on with a new crop of habits and be, you know, pressured into that. And before you know it, you got all these other bad habits and it got a hold of you. And you say, man, I got to go through another life trying to break all those other, these bad habits. And then when you try to do that, another crop of bad habits will come along. And it just never ends this way until you finally get to the mother of all bad habits, which is spiritual pretense, and break that. Truly get free of that habit. So in the light of this, I'm saying, well, you know, I have like maybe 30 more years to live in this world. I don't want to spend 30 years picking up all these bad habits. There's no way. And so what to do then? It's looking, okay, so, you know, how do we sidestep these bad habits? And the Holy Spirit seems very vigorous and urgent about this sidestepping. And so you don't want to get all those bad habits that the future here is going to bring. The Holy Spirit's very aware of this new crop of very bad habits, and I've been pointing them out in these videos. On and on and on and on, saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, I don't want that, the look of things that way, it's terrible. I don't want to get in a habit of mental habits of believing this way. Bad habits are mental habits of belief. And this world is absolutely pressuring everybody into a certain belief system, a way of believing, which will be very difficult to break those habits. Extraordinarily difficult. So I've already had more than enough difficulty breaking the mental habits of the belief system of continuity fear. Certainly don't want to reinvest in it. No way. So I'm very urgently asking the Holy Spirit to, you know, let us know how we can address this situation. And full of faith that it will address this at the right moment. And this sustainable development summit, where the agenda is going to be ratified, is basically a roadmap, a charter, you know, an agenda for the globe, for every single person on the globe, to adopt a certain belief system. This is what it is. It's a belief system. Pope and the president are on board with this belief system. You know, they like to play up the idea that they're at odds over certain issues, but this is just for public consumption. They're actually two peas in a pod, and they want this global sustainability agenda to they want to back it. They want everyone's belief system to be molded in this way, which is just absolutely chock full of terrible, terrible, terrible bad habits, mental habits. It's a disaster. It'll bring about so many bad habits. I say, oh boy, what a pain that's going to be getting free of those. So I sure don't. I'm not going to. I tell the Holy Spirit, I'm not going to do that. So give me an alternative. Let's give us an alternative. Not everybody wants to do this. Give us an alternative. I was driving home. I saw this big truck. And the Holy Spirit says, look at this truck. I said, yeah, I'm looking at it. Why? And suddenly I realized it's off on the shoulder. I said, why is driving on the shoulder? Why is this truck driving on the shoulder? And that was, you know, it wasn't completely on the shoulder, but it was the right side was on the shoulder of the road. I said, this is so odd. What is it doing? Well, it's sidestepping. God is showing me, Holy Spirit saying, look, you see, you can get over on and not be affected by it somehow. So these habits. So we'll see what creative approach, what creative answer the Holy Spirit has to this issue. It's a very important issue. It's coming to a head right now because this belief system is knocking everybody out right now. They're feeling they've got no choice. That's why I don't have a smartphone, because that will pull you into this new belief system very strongly. Try to minimize your involvement with artificial intelligence as much as practical, which I've been doing. Don't struggle with it. I do a little bit here with this taping, but that's pretty much it. I don't struggle with it. There's just this massive assumption on this planet that everybody's going to go along with it. This is a very bad habit they have. Technology is a very bad habit. Extraordinarily so. And we try to help these folks out, but they don't seem to be getting it. they got to dance too. They can't be dragging their heels. We try to help them out. They got to realize the opportunity and get with it. And they haven't done that. So it means it's really severe. Very severe bad habits they have. So I don't need those bad habits. We don't need those, do we? And so the push has come to shove now with this initiative. The Pope, this week in September, that this takes it too far. It goes too far. It says that basically it says, here's your future. Period. Everyone, this is for everyone. Everyone must get on board, and we're going to monitor your progress. Period. Well, thanks, but no thanks. Monitoring my progress into picking how well I pick up terrible bad habits? I don't think so. And bad habits are very clever and tricky. They present themselves in an appealing way, oftentimes. The continuity fear markets it that way, makes it look glossy, puts lip gloss on it. Put lip gloss on a pig. It's a bad habit. It's a really bad habit. And you may think, well, yeah, but it's got lip gloss. Well, it doesn't matter. It's still a bad habit. But then you get pulled into it, and then before you know it, you find breaking that habit is very difficult. And those who have broken a lot of bad habits, you know what I'm talking about, how difficult it is. And you don't want to have to, you're not eager to pick up some more bad habits at all. Like, I'm not interested in some phobia, picking up some phobia. I already had arachnophobia. That was terrible enough. It ended up dominating my life. I said, so terrible. I said, I can't go on this way. It's not possible. I mean, I cannot live this life anymore. I have to break this habit. But, it was hideous trying to break that habit. I know a lot of people have arachnophobia, actually. But you're looking at someone who broke that bad habit and got free of it. just through determination, will and determination, and saying, I just can't keep going on like this. It's ridiculous. It's absurd. Can't be controlled like this. But some, you know, still have it. They can't get free of it. Just live with it, which is awful. Living with, you know, but that's just one example. There are so many bad habits that people, most habits that people have are bad habits, actually. Very bad. They don't realize it. But when you start breaking these habits, you start realizing, oh my gosh, that's not helpful. This is not helpful. This is not helpful. And goes on and on and on. And the mistakes, you know, correcting mistakes, etc. takes a lot of work. So we hardly want to just get a whole bunch of other mistakes and bad habits. That's crazy. Foolish, beyond foolish. It's absurd. So the world's presenting an absurd option to me. It's completely absurd. This is how I see it. And so, I mean, that's why I'm not happy with the president or the pope or the United Nations or, you know, the secular humanists or anything. They're presenting, you know, this absurd option to me. Totally absurd. And nobody's happy if somebody presents an absurdity to them as if it wasn't absurd. You know, this is not good. How many of those of us in this world have ever said, you know, hey everybody who's not yet incarnated here, don't come back here thinking that I can make you happy, because I can't make you happy at all. It's absurd. So don't come here thinking I can make you happy. You know, how many of us, either male or female, have ever said that, you know, really felt that way? Like, don't, you know, I got bad habits. I'm messed up. I can't make you happy. Bodies can't make you happy at all. Special relationships can't make you happy in the slightest bit. It's going to be misery. Come back in here. Don't come here thinking that. Don't come here thinking that. No. Well, I don't know if anyone's ever said that. I've never heard anybody say this. Everybody acts like, oh, I'm God's gift to make you happy. This is absurd. Nobody makes us happy here. The only ones who really, you know, bring it are the saints, in terms of they're showcasing it is possible to reach this inner peace, right? But they're not making you happy. Their body's not making you happy. The advice they give is useful, but you still have to do it, you know, reach this inner peace for yourself, really. So I just noticed that. I just noticed today that it's just amazing how we don't hear that ever spoken like that. Astonishing. You know, hey guys, don't come into this world thinking that I'm some kind of bargain, you know. I'm good for you. I'm helpful for you. You know, I'm pleasing to you. You know, no. I'll make you miserable, is what I'll do. I'll make you absolutely miserable. I'll drive you crazy. Don't come here thinking that I'm, just because I'm beautiful, I'm not gonna drive you crazy. Of course I will. I'm messed up. I got so many bad habits. I'm confused and projecting, and I've got this severe continuity fear. I'll make you miserable. I mean, we could be miserable together, sure. That's about it. We'll be miserable together. So inform those who want to come into this world or still, you know, not identifying yet with some body. Say, hey, don't come here thinking that, you know, you're going to be anything less than totally miserable. And these people that think they're God's gift, you know, to the world or something, no. Unless they're truly, you know, abiding in inner peace, and true peace, and abiding in peace of mind, then that is God's gift to everyone. But other than that, no. So humanism preaches the opposite. It says, they tell you, you're God's gift to, you know, to everyone. You're, you know, you're the prince, you're the princess. You know, you make, you know, just people should feel honored just to be in your presence. I mean, come on down, everybody, into this world. My gosh, we got so many beautiful people here. So many beautiful bodies that are going to make you so happy. You know, this is an atrocious lie. An atrocious, atrocious lie and deceit. People should say, don't you dare come down here and think that I'm able to make you happy. Don't you dare be so stupid. How dare you be so arrogant to think that a body is going to make you happy. Somebody is going to make you happy. This is just nothing but sheer arrogance. Don't you dare think that way. This is how we should be communicating with those who have passed on and thinking about coming back. Don't you dare think about coming back here. And not at all. So this is very much flipping the script. So many here in the world think that they're, you know, here, they're gifting people by, you know, associating, having a special relationship with them, you know, like, wow, you don't realize how fortunate you are. You know, I'm so beautiful. I'm so lovely. I'm so nice. I'm so this. I'm so that. I'm so strong. I'm so rich. I'm so capable, you know, whatever. This is utter nonsense. Just bold-faced lie. So the world should, instead of screaming, help, help, come into the world, come into the world, you have to come into the world, help me out, because I need somebody to think that I'm wonderful, you know, the special, that my body, special relationship, that I'm a wonderful human being. Anyone who thinks they're a wonderful human being is completely cuckoo. There's no such thing as a wonderful human being. Anyone who thinks they're a wonderful human being is insane. Is really suffering from extreme continuity fear. I don't think I'm a wonderful human being, not at all. Not at all. I'm not trying to be. What I'm working for is abidance and peace of mind. And that's a different story. It's a different story. I'd say I'm working towards a wonderful mind. But a good human being, no, not a nice human being. Not a good human being at all. Nobody is. Well, we could, you know, insanity is very contagious. Anyone thinks they're a wonderful human being is insane. So what they're really saying, hey, come experience my insanity. It's wonderful. No, it's not. It's very contagious. It's very contagious. Stay away. Stay away. Stay away. Stay away from that. Wonderful night. Perfect California day. It's a gorgeous day. Wow. All these incredible clouds, scattered high clouds that just put on this display all day long. Beautiful sunset, warm day, just a slightly cool evening. You know, just another picture postcard day. Just, I wanted to take pictures of the sky. It was so beautiful. Wow, all these wispy, spread out, little clouds dotting the sky everywhere with all these different patterns. But this very azure sky, you know, so blue and clear, and just say, wow, this is really the mecca for those who enjoy good weather. It is the ultimate mecca, no question about it. If it was such a nice day, I said, hey, today's the day. You know, you got to abide in peace of mind today. Got to. This is such a beautiful day. It has to happen today. I really pressed it today. It's got to happen. Well, hasn't happened, unfortunately. But I tried pressing as much as possible. You know, really, really pressed it. It felt like today's the day. The day was so nice. It felt like today must be the day. The day deserves this. The day so beautiful deserves this. Absolutely deserves it. Deserves to have someone finally, you know, accept peace of mind and recognize that there are no people. There is no world. Never has been. There's just just been our pretense, that's all. A day, a lovely day like this, like a thank you to us, you know, it deserves. May all days be this beautiful and even more beautiful. And let us accept the thanks that we really have within us for being reasonable, you know, and recognizing in a reasonable way, you know, how to resolve the situation and honor our creativity. And so let ourselves be treated. Speaking of that, I had some macaroons yesterday, some very delicious macaroons. I never had tasted anything like that. It was so good. Wow, that was a treat. So I'm getting treated. It's a funny thing. I am getting treated in various ways I never expected. Delicacies are being brought to me, and it's like, wow, beautiful days. Oh, something else very important to talk about. Very important. In playing golf, I started out first hole, okay, second hole, and then suddenly got to the third hole. My God, suddenly slowed down. There's this foursome up there, and they're going real slow. I'm a single. And there's another single ahead of me, one behind me, and I said, oh my gosh, we'll never get through at this rate. This is going to be a nightmare here. And so, I saw that they waved the guy ahead of me through, play through. So I was playing the hole behind him. I finished it and I went up to him, and they're still there. I said, what's going on here? I said, so I started waiting for them. They didn't even see me. I said, I wonder if they're going to just wave me through too. What's going on here? They don't seem to be playing much. Well, it's a very interesting situation. Ultimately, they said to me, play through. I said, okay, great. Thank you. Boom, play through. But I saw what the situation was. It was God showing me something, a test. It was showing me the way, what's going on in the world. And there was two guys in one cart, and then a lady and a young man in another. And the lady was like drunk out of her mind. She was in a very loose, drunk, you know, condition, say the least. And the guys were just, the older guys were just digging this, you know. They just were enjoying this. Hey, what's she going to do? You know, what, she's going to get crazy or something, you know. You know, they're very attracted. They felt, I could feel like they were, you know, they like being around this drunk woman because they don't know, you know, what, how mischievous and loose she's going to be. And I saw it, and so they weren't even interested in playing golf. They just like, well, we just want to do whatever this lady's doing. We want to hang around with her. Well, she couldn't play worth a darn because she was so drunk, and so they weren't going anywhere. They were just missing the ball, topping it, hitting this. I mean, they weren't going. But the guys were saying, no, we want to stay, go slow, because this lady is all drunk, and maybe she'll take her clothes off or something, right? That's what they're hoping. But I said, to heck with that, you know, I want to get through this golf course. So I just said, hey, I'm out of here. I'm down. So I slammed a drive down the middle, slammed another shot in a par five, and I was, you know, left them in the dust. But I realized, you said, wow, this is the world. It's the women of the world. There's so many, they're like drunk. They're in this drunken-like attitude, actually. Like they're saying, hey, I just might feel like, I'm going to just feel like take my clothes off or something, you know, wow. You know, they have this attitude like, hey guys, I'm a little bit, I'm very, very, my mind is very much, you know, whorish, whores of Babylon, I call them. The Bible uses the term whores of Babylon. We're feeling very whorish right now, and drunk and drugged, and wow, you don't know what's going to happen, guys. You might get really lucky, you know. I mean, it's your lucky day, it's your lucky time, it's your lucky epic. And the guys, not only the young guys, but a lot of older guys are thinking, wow, these younger women, man, I might get lucky, you know. And these older guys are like that. And the younger guys are saying, wow, these are some loose, wild women, you know. And they're slowing down. They say, whoa, we don't want to really, you know, leave that behind. We don't want to sidestep that. We want to kind of hang around with that. This is exactly what's happening. Holy Spirit was showing me. This is what's happening. And what my attitude was, no way, I'm out of here. Boom, you know. See you later. Not interested. I gotta find my game, you know? I'm not gonna hang around some floozy, drunk floozy. So, but the world is in this situation now where there's so many whores of Babylon, they're trying to slow everything down. They don't want anyone to finish. It's continuity fear exerting itself, asserting itself, too, asserting and exerting itself. And, you know, there's nothing that will slow guys down more than some drunk woman, some beautiful drunk woman who's just like, whoa, guys, you guys look really wonderful to me. I'm really funny. I'm feeling very uninhibited. I'm so uninhibited. Look at me, you know, wow, what's going to happen next? The guys are going to get fixated on that. So many guys will get fixated. This is a global situation. The guys are very fixated now, and they've stopped. Stop practicing spiritual, spiritual progress. They just said, hey, I mean, those guys were, you know, if that woman wasn't moving her golf cart, those guys would have stayed there all day. They would have just stayed there, said, play through, play through, play through, play through. And then indeed, they did let the guy behind me play through, too. They just play through, play. They said, we're not even interested in playing golf. We're just sit here, we're just watching this drunk floozy, you know. And she wasn't going anywhere either. She couldn't even drive the golf cart. And so they just stalled out, completely stalled out. And this is what's happening with the world. The world is just stalling out. The guys are just stalling out because the whores of Babylon are doing their dance. Yeah, doing their dance. So it's hooked so many guys. It's just ridiculous. Not a few. I mean, the vast majority of the planet is stalled out. Spiritually stalled out. Spiritually stalled out. And no one's helped them with it, really. This is a crying shame. It's an absolute tragedy. I tried to do something about it. I hope that there'd be some expedient we could use to get the guys, you know, off of these drunken floozies, the whores of Babylon, who have this, you know, attitude. Very, oh my gosh, some woman came into the store today. It's unbelievable. There's all guys in the store. She walked in, and just had written all over her, you know, whore of Babylon. No doubt about it. Dressed exactly the way, you know, just, and every guy is just, everybody's like, you know, looking like, wow, wow, wow. And all their attention got off their work, what they're doing, you know, and there's like, oh, can I help you? Oh, look at her, you know, wow. You know, of course she knew exactly what she was doing. That's just getting everybody's attention. You know, dressed in skin tight this and, you know, just projecting this, you know, I'm a slut, you know, no question about it, guys, you know, don't you like this? And I just said, well, I'm out of here, you know, I'm out of here, and, you know, left. I'm not going to hang around, because the guys are, like, snickering and looking, and, you know, and it gets their attention. It's attention grabber. Someone send someone in like that to a room full of guys, and 90% of the guys are going to have their attention completely distracted. And a few wise ones say, I'm out of here. I'm not going to hang around here. Because I end up getting distracted too. Because all the other guys are saying, hey, you know, look. It ends up being a very, very distracting situation. Whereas a decent woman walk in and everyone will just treat her decently and not be distracted and respect the fact that he's not trying to distract us. And easy if you want it to be that way. But not this woman that walked in. Yeah, you see how proud she was. I was like, well, I'm an expert at distracting men. I'm an expert at this. And, you know, nobody can resist. Yeah, well, we can sidestep and just, you know, take off. Just, you know, goodbye, I'm out of here. I'm not going to tempt myself. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, right? So, just sidestep it. So that's what I did. That's what I did on this golf course. And Holy Spirit was saying, this is a lesson, you see? It passed the lesson. I'm seeing more and more of that. I can see these lessons and you can see how people are functioning now. And it's a game of distraction that's going on in the world. So don't try to overcome it. Just sidestep it. Because, you know, this is not something you want to mess around with. You know, you don't want to engage those type of women. For me, like, you don't want to engage them at all. And trying to straighten them out or trying to help. No. They're not interested in being engaged. They're interested in conquest, you know, distracting you, slowing you down, stalling you out. Absolutely, that's what they're after. To, you know, make them feel comfortable with idolizing continuity fear and say continuity fear is this is what's going to save me. Continuity fear says, hey, this will show you how powerful you can be when you follow my advice and how wonderful everything's going to be for you. So more and more the Holy Spirit is just showing me, get out of Dodge, just get out of there. Don't try to deal with it. Don't try to struggle with it. Don't struggle with it. Just like on that golf hole, I just went to the tee real fast, teed up, boom, jumped in the cart, thank you, goodbye. Yeah. I didn't engage him in any sort of talk or anything like that. I did say, back up your cart because it might be in the way, but ultimately it wasn't in the way. But they didn't even know how to back up the cart. It couldn't even function. So I said, well, okay, whatever, I'm out of here. So in other words, that was showing me, the Holy Spirit showing me, they're unable to back down at this time. This lady was so out of it, she couldn't even know how to put the cart in reverse, couldn't even reverse it. You know, ditzy and all this kind of stuff. So she's in the way, a little bit in the way, or in harm's way, no, but I was able to, you know, say, okay, it's you're far enough, so it's not going to be an issue, but it'd be nice if you could back up a bit, but couldn't. So I'm not going to hang around waiting for you to back up when you don't know how to, and struggling with it, no way. You know, and they act ditzy too, like, oh, I just don't know how to do it, I'm so drunk, can you help me, you know, this, and then they, you know, get you, you know, they fall on you and stuff. This is an act, you know, this is what they do, this is an act. So don't try to help them, don't try to help them when they're, I can't back up this cart, I'm so drunk, you know, well, you're not really bothering me anyway, so goodbye. Very important to have this attitude. Don't struggle with the horrors of Babylon. And with the other side, you might say, you know, don't the women don't struggle with the nice guys and the guys who seem to be nice, humanistic, secular humanistic, really nice to you, nice. No, forget it. Pass them by. No, nobody's good or nice. No human being, no one who thinks they're a human is good or nice. Don't get trapped by those so-called nice guys. Forget it. Just bypass them. Oh, let me help you. I'm just here to help you out. No thanks. You know, go. You know, the knight in shining armor. Avoid the knight in shining armor. And go towards the inner shining. Go towards your own inner shining. You know, and that, you don't want shining armor. You just want shining. So the knight in shining armor is deceitful because inside they're not shining. They have reflecting shininess, but they're not really spiritual. Spiritual, they're humanists. Again, a saint, someone who's saved is a different story. It's a different story. Don't get them mixed up with what we're talking about here. The saints are shining with peace, you know, but it's a stable abidance in peace, peace of mind. That's a different story, isn't it? Yeah, so men can seem very so helpful and courteous and nice, and let me take care of this and this and this. And just say, no, I don't need anything taken care of. I'm fine. And, you know, tee off and get out of there. Well, let me fix this. No, it's okay. I'll just, you know, limp along with, you know, whatever. I don't need that. No, thank you. Thanks, but no thanks. So we got to be wise and brisk. The Holy Spirit says it was urgent, fast, you know. So I get later in the day, I'm feeling kind of like, wow, it didn't happen today, and I know it's so urgent. This is really terrible. I walk into a store, and there's a song playing. Hold On, Help Is On The Way by Little River Band. LRB, for those who are old-timers, LRB, Little River Band. Hold On, Help Is On The Way. Yeah, great song. And so I kept hearing this song, and it picked me up. I said, wow, that's great. Holy Spirit saying, help is on the way. I'll be there. Hold On, Help Is On The Way. I'll be there as fast as I can. Hold On, Help Is On The Way. I'll be there as fast as I can. Wow, that's great. Because the sense of urgency now is very strong. There's no question that the New World Agenda is shifting into overdrive. You know, it really is. Google telling everybody in the Silicon Valley, guess what, folks? You need to ride your bikes. We're gonna make turn this place into Copenhagen or something, where everybody has to ride their bikes. Well, thanks, but no thanks. No, bikes are quite dangerous. Not just cars. Not just because of cars. For lots of reasons. It's for young people mostly. I don't particularly want Google telling me what my future is going to be, but they seem to have no shame in doing so. They say, well, we've already got it plotted out and planned, so, you know, this is how it's going to be. Well, actually, you're late to the party, Google, because the Holy Spirit, our salvation, our future, truly plotted out and planned for us, so, and that's how it's going to be. It's just, party crasher. All these big firms and stuff, they're just party crashers is all. They're just trying to crash the Holy Spirit's party. And they're outsiders looking in, you know, old Dan Tucker looking for cyber appearance. Hard times come again no more. Peeking through the window, all the folks, and they're eating the good food. Yeah, they want to get in there and get some. They're just impoverished party crashers trying to crash the Holy Spirit's party here and everywhere. And it doesn't work that way. You can't crash the Holy Spirit's party. And you say, well, what about us? Well, you got to repent. No, I can't repent. Well, you got to. I don't know how. Well, the Holy Spirit will help you. It's funny that Google's so weepy about, you know, there's too many cars. Well, guess what, Google? It's your hiring. You're buying up apartment complexes and building them as fast as possible and to stuff thousands and thousands of more people so you can, you know, so we can work to, you know, work for you, etc. All these companies are hiring like crazy and they're building like crazy and they're, guess what? Those people cause greater density. Duh, wow. How about downsizing, Google? There'll be less cars and less trouble. You know, they're the ones causing the very problem that they are seeking to fix. But they never hear about them maybe downsizing themselves and laying off all these rich young techies and say, well, we don't really need you anymore because we're not really going to take over the world. And you never hear that. Never hear that. No. We need to hire thousands and thousands and thousands and more. You know, cause gridlock everywhere in Silicon Valley. But we have a solution. Let's everybody ride bicycles. Yeah, maybe young people say, oh, yeah, sure, that's a great. But no, it's not really so great. A lot of people have to live far away. I mean, we're not all crammed into apartment complexes near the Google campus, you know? This is a very spread out area. And we have to go all sorts of different places. I mean, really it shows how tyrannical these firms are. This is their viewpoint. They think nothing of just saying, oh, we're going to re-engineer your future completely And guess what? You're going to love it because we said you would, because we're nice people. Very tyrannical. They need to go into rehab. So maybe they need to ride their bike to rehab. Maybe we need to buy the Google campus and turn into a rehab facility for all these techies with all these bad habits of arrogantly thinking that they know what's best for us. They know better than the Holy Spirit, they think. The Holy Spirit, all these old folks, they believe in the Holy Spirit. You know, now we believe in artificial intelligence. You know? Yeah. Yeah, those old folks, we really gotta help them out because they're really hung up on some bad habits. Like they actually believe in God and the Holy Spirit and spiritual practice and enlightenment and saints and gurus, saviors, and the saviors coming back to this world to help us out and maybe going to some other paradise and another dimension. And they actually believe a death-free realm. Wow, you know, they really need help. But don't worry, artificial intelligence will help them out. We'll meld their minds with some, you know, robot, and they won't suffer from these delusions anymore. So we're really, you know, we're here to do no evil. We're here to help poor folks. Actually, believe that stuff? Wow, that's weird. It's really weird. That's very unrobotic of them. It's being very unrobotic. It can't be unrobotic. That's not civil. You can't be anti-artificial intelligence. That's not civil. That's not tolerant. It's not inclusive. We need to include robots in our lives. We need to include artificial intelligence everywhere. That's being inclusive. Well, how about including the Holy Spirit everywhere? Let's start with that. Because reason tells us that's the way where to start. And then we'll go from there and see what the Holy Spirit advises us. That's true inclusivity right there. Let's start our inclusivity program, folks, all you folks in rehab, with the Holy Spirit. Can't argue against that, can you? Nobody can. And then go from there. Except actually what they do is they exclude the Holy Spirit. Start with excluding it and go from there. And they say, yeah, we're really smart. We're smart people. We're smart young people making a lot of money, being really smart. I think we figured out the answer how to be really smart and rich is exclude the Holy Spirit and then start from there. Wow. Then we teach everyone how to be inclusive. We have an inclusivity agenda for everybody. So tomorrow is what Friday is Pope's addressing the UN and it's the Vatican City, the Holy See, Vatican City, the Vatican flag is going to be flying high there. My God, the Pope is treated like some conqueror here at Congress, you know, lecturing Congress. Lecturing the president, lecturing Congress, then appearing on the balcony just like it would at St. Peter's. Holy cow. Accorded a hero's, a conqueror's welcome. It's like ancient Rome again. And the generals just come back and said, guess what? We defeated Carthage and sacked it. And everybody's like giving all, they all show up and give, you know, Hail Caesar, Hail Caesar, Hail Caesar, Hail Caesar. You know. And you know, it's like that. Hail, hail, hail. My gosh. People went absolutely nuts. Like some great conqueror has arrived. The Messiah has arrived, you know. It's like, wow. Very amazing. People are being overcome by it, you know. It's like a historic moment. So I put the headphones on, I listened to it, and I felt like, oh, you could feel the emotion of it, like it was some super historic moment that people have been waiting for, that the Pope appears over the Congress of the United States, high up in this massive building beneath the great rotunda, you know, appears on the balcony to this huge throng outside and blesses, 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 blesses. There's something a little odd about that, you know? Yeah. Are they going to let the Dalai Lama do the same? Let him, Dalai Lama, come walk out on the balcony like that, and surrounded by all the dignitaries, and bless the crowd. It'll probably be a big crowd to come see Dalai Lama too. I don't know. I don't think that's exactly going to happen. So this is heavy duty global politics here, global agenda politics here. This is very, very, very much. The whole thing was choreographed to give great cachet to the United Nations agenda, global agenda. The Pope was hitting on all these. It's funny, the Pope was hitting on all this in his talk. He's hitting on all these targets of the Sustainable Development Initiative, New World Agenda. He's basically, because he obviously knows what's going on. He's not stupid. He's very, very well informed about this agenda, sustainability and sustainable development initiative of the United Nations, and he's going to dare to the summit to address it. And so in his speech, he included all these issues, which are very much in line with this initiative. And he's like above the Congress saying, hey, folks, here I am, you know. Here's your real leader. It's not Congress in the United States, it's me. Smiling and saying, "Yeah, I know I'm the rock star. I'm the superstar." But again, didn't deliver a word of the gospel of Jesus Christ. First, include the Holy Spirit everywhere, and then we'll talk about inclusivity everywhere. We'll go from there. That's the first step of inclusivity everywhere. Holy Spirit everywhere. All right, very simple. Oh, it's pretty late, actually. We're now have arrived at, I believe, the 25th of September. Yes, indeed we have. Here on the West Coast, it is the 25th of September. Wow. This is the day. Wow. Big day. Big, important day. And after this, we have the 28th of the last of the four blood moons. The Holy Spirit's indicated this is a pivotal time in the history of this planet. And not really planet, but the history of our consciousness, spiritual consciousness here. Pivotal week in the history of in history of our spiritual consciousness. Which way are we going to go? As Yogi Berra said, when there's a fork in the road, take it. It's just a question of which way, which one to take, right? So, something will both happen and not happen, that's for sure. Something will both happen and not happen. You can both count on that and not count on it. And this is not a joke. This is how we speak to our continuity fear. This is how we make this peace accord, saying, hey, I'm acknowledging you. I want to move on, but I'm also acknowledging you. And we're not going to move on until you feel truly acknowledged. Period. You know, tell yourself that. I'm not moving on. Yes, I will move on, but I will not move on at all until you feel truly acknowledged. All the expressions of suffering and pretense. Until you feel truly acknowledged, I'm not going anywhere. Make that peace accord with yourself. Tell yourself this, and you will find there's a great thankfulness within you for this. I don't know what's coming my way next. I keep getting delicacies coming my way. Great stuff keeps coming my way. It seems like blessings keep coming my way, keep coming my way. I don't know what the next blessing will be. I'll accept it. I'm not going anywhere until every expression feels totally blessed. Let's put it this way. I'm not going anywhere until every expression that I of continuity fear that's ever, you know, feels totally blessed. Totally blessed. Totally acknowledged, totally blessed. I'm not going anywhere. I take it very seriously. They let me go from being a hostage. They freed me from being a hostage, and I promised them, so I'll keep my promise. So I'm telling them, you know, line up in a row, get in a circle here. Let's get the blessing going here. You know, be acknowledged, feel the acknowledgement, feel the blessing. I insist upon it, you know, that you truly are blessed. Thank you for everything you've done, all the suffering, everything. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You know, be blessed, be blessed, be absolutely blessed. And when you do this, you find you have a different accord. You feel that they'll return the blessing, you know, I don't know. Each in their humble way, you know, I don't know what they're going to do. There might be a massive amount of blessing. There's certainly a massive amount of expressions we've used in pretense. So, really have this feeling of gratitude towards every one of these continuity fear expressions. Great gratitude. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I absolutely acknowledge you. But also, I absolutely want to move on, which they're happy to hear, because they don't want to keep being these expressions, right? So I say, I absolutely don't accept you, but I neither accept you nor do I reject you. I neither accept you nor do I reject you. And they feel the acknowledgement from that. Also, you're acknowledging, you're ready to move on, which they're very happy to hear too. They don't want to keep being expressing depression and sickness and death. Not at all. And I also talked to my body today. I said, hey, body, you know, this is being sick and infirm and all these problems is just an expression of the personality, an excuse to not recognize where the problem really is. That's all. That's all it is. I say, you're not supposed to be infirm and sick and wearing out at all. The personality just wants you to wear out, to hide where it's really coming from, the attitude where it's really coming from. It's just being projected on the body. Body doesn't have to wear out at all. I said, body, you don't have to wear out at all. That's ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. So, you know, I expect the body to drop its infirmity at some, you know, some point, really. There's no need for the body to wear out. It's just an excuse we're using. Say, well, I have to die, I have to get sick, I have to get old. Is the body is doing this? No, the body's not doing anything. We can just as easily, when we have this inner peace accord, we can say, body, you know, be well. You don't have to be infirm at all. Do not have to be infirm at all. You no longer need to be infirm, body. It's a fact. It's an absolute fact. None of these continuity fear issues need to use you in that way anymore. They're elated. They're so grateful. They're so thankful. They're so blessed. You know, they don't need to use the body to disguise, you know, their expressions as if the body was causing them these expressions. No, they don't. So be totally functional, body. Be perfectly functional. This is what this is the way you need to be. It's the way you should be. Be perfectly functional to carry out any communications that need to be carried out. So we're touching upon this. Well, this will be clarified more or not. We'll see how it goes. And both, you know, both clarified and not clarified. Neither clarified nor not clarified. So it's pretty cool to have a dream where, like, you feel like in this mood of totally stable friendship, just doesn't look just incredible amiableness, or just, you know, stable, doesn't disappear. I was like just a picture of friendliness in the dream, and it wouldn't go away. It just stayed stable. No fluctuation at all. It was just smooth, stable. Very nice to have a dream like that. That indicates something profound is taking place, going on. So, it both is and isn't taking place. This is our practice. Helps greatly. Immediately feels a sense of calm by saying that. We don't need a scapegoat. The body just uses a scapegoat. When we reach this inner peace accord, there's no more need for any scapegoat. So the body doesn't need to be sick or infirm at all. This is simply not needed. No longer needed. And we thank all these expressions, creative expressions of believing that the body needs to be infirm this way or infirm this way or infirm that way. They're all blessed too. They're all blessed too. And they say, hey, I'm blessed. I don't need to ask the body to get arthritis or, you know, have problems, get old or something. No, I don't need that anymore. You know, these expressions are no longer required. No longer part of the now elation and blessedness and thankfulness and gratitude is what's being expressed to spirit, to what we are by being reasonable here. So my spirit may or may not experience this. Both experience it and not experience it. Experience this. Will both abide in this and not abide in this. There will neither be abidance nor will there be not be abidance. There will neither be abidance in this nor will there not be abidance in this. So this acknowledges our continuity fear expressions first, off the bat. There will neither be abidance, acknowledging continuity fear expressions, nor will there not be abidance. Also saying, and I'm going to move on. This is about, you know, getting things right so we can move on and no more need to pretend at all. Okay, how are we doing in this video? Very great. Oh my God! Whoa! Wait a minute. It's almost at 2 hours, and I've used 1.79 gigabytes. This is just CPU usage, 43%. How is this possible? I've used less than half of the 4 gigabytes, and we're almost at 2 hours. So you're talking, looking at like a 4-hour video, possible, but it's already 12:21. Wow. I don't know what to say about this. I got a normal picture here. I just got the gain completely turned down. Exposure and brightness are up. Wow. Whatever it is, I mean, the picture's fine here. It's good, it's great. But it's using extreme low amount of memory to code this. Ah, what a surprise. Great. I can now do a 4-hour video. We can listen to a 4-hour video. Why not? Because I have to get up in the morning at some point and work. Otherwise, maybe I would. I've said enough here. It's a lot of wow factors here. Hang on, help is on the way. Hang on, help is on the way. I'll get there as fast as I can. This is a great song. So the key is to let all those cognitive fear expressions, that creativity that was used for them, let that creativity now be used for gratitude towards spirit, towards what you are, towards gratitude. Allow the gratitude and thanks to be expressed. Allow them to express this gratitude and thanks. I told them all. I said, just be elated. Just allow yourself to be absolutely elated at this situation. Go ahead. It's okay. All that expression of depression, allow yourself to be completely elated now. Absolutely elated. Don't worry about too much elation. Bathe in that elation. Just bathe in it. You don't have to express that anymore. See? You're freed from it. But we honor the creativity involved, but no longer need to express the misery involved. So hang on, I'll be there as fast as I can, to the Holy Spirit, and remember, it's about allowing these expressions that were previously used to torment you, allowing them to now feel elated. This is forgiveness, forgiving yourself, over practicing your self-forgiveness. I'm saying, hey, depression, feel elated, absolutely feel totally elated. You deserve it. What a great servant you've been, and how terrible it was to ask you to be so depressed. So give permission to all these expressions that have been tormenting you for so long to be absolutely elated. This is real self-forgiveness. This is what we need to do. And then it will come back. Enormous thanks and gratitude will be shining on us. People wonder, what in the world happened to them? Wow, what's going on? They seem to be, in this... they seem to be someone seems to have a great many great friends. They may look at you and say, wow, you must have some awesome friends. They must be treating you great. They must think you're wonderful. So allow that to happen. And so the issue is, of course, if you think, oh, this cancer I had, or whatever this problem I had, I hate that. I'm going to punish that forever. This is the problem. This is what the misstep, the mistake. It's our own pretense. The creativity is not to blame at all. Okay, even the pretense that we think is some separate expression is never separate from us. But we're honoring the creativity involved in it as if it were. So we say, by all means, be elated. You absolutely deserve it. And allow this for all expressions of suffering you've ever suffered throughout all incarnations. Give them all. So you all deserve total elation. Do it now. Do it now. Accept it right now. Don't have to wait another second. I'm not asking you to wait another second. Full on elation right now. And then this will rebound to you, because the gratitude will just be extraordinary towards you. You might use off the charts. You don't even want to measure how great the gratitude is. They'll treat you like the divinity that you really are. You'll start feeling, wow, I'm being treated like I'm divine. Well, we are. Everyone's divine. We're all divine spirit. We're all divinity. We're all the one family of divine spirit. perfect inclusiveness, perfect standing, can never be changed. So you will start feeling like, well, I'm being treated like divinity here. And people notice that, like, wow, this person seems like they have some sort of divinity about them, you know. Well, that's because we're being treated like we're divine. Really, really, really treated like we're divine. Not by some special relationship or bodies or personalities or anything, no, but by all our own creativity now that's has so much gratitude toward us, you know. Undefinable, immeasurable gratitude towards us. Saying, wow, only divinity could forgive like this, you know. This is what it says. It says, my God, I'm being forgiven. Only divinity could give this type of forgiveness. So you must be divine. We know you are, you know, talking to spirit. We know that you truly are divine. So your own self recognizes itself. You might say self-recognizing divinity of self here. This is how it's done. Now, this isn't unorthodox. It's just very advanced, in the eyes of the world, at least. Based on what we think is normal, the baseline of what we think a normal baseline, you know, it seems super advanced. But it's just very reasonable. Self-forgiveness. And you might not have heard of this much before, right? Not many have gotten to this yet. But we've gotten to it. We're here with it. So just be in the wow with it. And thank you, everybody who's watching. There's still some of you who are watching these videos, you know, maybe even like 50 or more. That's great. I don't know how long people watch. I mean, I can check. You know, a lot of times, not so long. But, you know, if you are watching this, you got to be saying, wow. This is a huge, huge, huge historic moment. Wow. We've gotten to this understanding and recognition and clarification. Wow. Self-forgiveness and how it works. And we can do a carte blanche. I mean, for just all, I'm not trying to point out any particular expression. I think just every single one. Right now. Totally elation right now. Totally blessed right now. Be totally blessed right now. Every single one. I'm not even thinking about the trees in the forest. I'm saying, hey, forest. All of the forest. Blessed right now. Blessed right now, the whole forest. So I don't need to worry about, you know, this tree. Entire forest, every tree with no exception whatsoever. No exception whatsoever. So that then rebounds, this self-forgiveness rebounds to us. And we experience, you know, this great gratitude of recognition, that the recognition comes to us. We're being recognized as being divine, saying, hey, only divinity could do this. So, therefore, you must be divine, you know, must be perfect. And so it starts dawning. The dawn comes to us, begins to dawn upon us, what we truly are. Self-forgiveness, as Jesus points out, forgiveness is the path. We must forgive ourselves. And this is what we're doing here. We're right on it, right on it. Beat the Pope to the punch. This is our thing. Beat the Pope to the punch. Before the Pope addressed the United Nations, we've got this done. We did it. I'll have this video up so you'll be able to view it in the morning. Beat the Pope to the punch. Self-forgiveness. Forgive yourself. This is how you do it. So this is great. This is great. 25th of September. Thank you very much already. You've already delivered a tremendous gift. Tremendous, tremendous gift here has already been delivered. Better than a macaroon. All right, so we will continue with this self-forgiveness, no question about it, and experience how that goes. All right, very great. Full stop in the wow, big wow. Just let the full stop happen. Don't dig too much into music videos. I gotta stay away from those. And whatever else you use to distract yourself, now just try to stay with the wow. All right, very great. That's it for this one.